The Young Marshal by Eileen Chang. Chapter 1. At the house party, all the girls came out on the veranda to look at the street. A man down below tossed up a sheet of paper folded into a twin hearts knot. They picked it up, untwisted it, and read, "Young lady, wait for me this time tomorrow." They rushed indoors in a body. They were the first generation with unbound feet. Even in satin slippers, the new big feet made them seem like a boisterous crowd. "This must be for you." They passed the slip of paper around. "Says who? More likely for you." "Why me of all people?" "Who told you to be so pretty?" "Me pretty? That's you yourself. I never even saw what sort of a person it was." "And who did? I had no idea what happened when everybody starts running." The fourth Miss Chu was too young to have to protest. She just grinned from under the bangs that blacked out the top half of her face. They stayed overnight. The next day at the same hour, the girl said, "See if the man is here again." They hid behind a window and peered out. Hippie with their posteras thrust out in the figured satin trousers and their thick pigtail hanging down the cleavage. The young ones had two pigtails, but most were 18, 19, and engaged to be married. They were so excited over this, it was plain that they had never been in love. Fourth Miss was a little ashamed of the way they kept watch all afternoon. The man never came. She, herself, had been in love a long time. She went to the Marshal's house on all birthdays and festivals. There it was always somebody's birthday, either the old Marshal's or one of the concubines. Not the son's, as it was bad taste to celebrate a youngster's birthday with 3 days feasting and command performance by all the best-known actors. The Chus were invited on the central day, so there was no danger of their running into more rowdy elements like the army officers. The elder son of the house was an officer himself. Sometimes he appeared in a long gown, sometimes a western suit, but she liked him best in uniform. Men's gowns were considered decadent and western clothes foppish, or like a compadre. A military uniform was both modern and patriotic. Soldiers were different. They were strong-armed beggars. The officers were feared in a different way. They had all the real power. When they happened to be young and manly, they seemed to be the country's only hope. The young marshal, as everybody called him, was very handsome. When he left, he had a sarcastic look, even with children. They followed him around. He carried on a conversation on a dead telephone for their benefit. She could not stand up for laughing. Once, she went to watch the singers make up for their roles. An actor was using his study as a retiring room, but the actor was on. "Why don't you cut your hair?" he asked. "Why these pigtails? We are republic now." He chased her around the room with a pair of scissors. She was laughing until he held out a bushy black bunch to her. "Here, you want to keep this?" She burst out crying. At home they would scold, and what would father say? But it was only a false beard. She had seen many private performances at relatives in her own house too. Unlike the musty theaters, these were in a courtyard under a roof of fresh matting casting a summery shade. The new stage lit by blue-white gas lights and the hubbub of a holiday crowd totally transformed home life. The feeling that something wonderful was going on and that she did not quite catch drove her to go in front, see better, somehow protrude herself, get hit on the head by the shattering gongs and cymbals. She would put her hands on the stage boards and stare upward. The heroine stood right above her piping her song, plucking her own sleeve showing off the flowing white cuff. Her headdress of black ringed brilliance flashed blue. Two long slabs of hoosh from eyelid to jaw marked off a narrow white nose. The warrior's paint face loomed large as a devil's mask. His singing also came out in a bottled boom as if from behind a clay mask. A kick and leap flung up dust that forth Miss could smell, stinking slightly of horse dung. There was still something she was missing. She circled the three sides of the stage hand over hand. Those sitting in the front row reached out to protect their glasses of jasmine tea placed between the footlights. At the theaters, she had seen people ushered on stage out of the wings in the middle of a performance and chairs set out for them in a row. They were important people with their family and concubines. It was said to be vulgar showing off, but she envied them up there in the midst of things, although it was doubtful they could see more from behind the actors. That was when she was little. In the days of Wu Peng Hu, as they say, before that was Tuan Cheng Lai's time. Now it's Feng Yixian. In the south is Fang Sheng Quan. Even the Amas knew the warlords by name. They may not know who the president was, but they always knew who was actually in charge and called him by his name. The one curious instance of democracy in a nominal republic. The old marshal was the only exception in this house because of his special connection with the master. Fourth Miss was hazy about their reigns and changeovers. A combination of snobbery and caution kept the wards out of polite conversation and reduced them to the level of city crime talks. A matter of staying in and watching the doors. There's fighting outside, nobody goes out. She would hear along with the boom of distant guns. The resident tutor taught as usual, but the English woman would not come for the girls' English lessons. Phoebe Chu, 1925. The teacher had dictated the line on the flyleaves of all her books. The name Phoebe was just for the teacher's convenience. Her other given name was also not known outside the schoolroom. Her father was supposed to use it, but he seldom had occasion to address her. She was just called Fourth Miss. The old marshal coming inside the palace last year had rented the former palace of a Manchu prince. The parties on its huge grounds were as big as a fair. Acrobats and minstrels under the mat awning, picking opera on the big parlor, another performance for the ladies in a second parlor. Mahjong in every other courtyard, fireworks after midnight. She drifted around with big red bows on her pigtails, her long gown a stiff trapezoid, white sleeves tucked out flat and triangular above the wrist that dangled foolishly by her sides. People said the young marshal was sweet on the Ju sisters and often took them out dancing, of which he was very fond. She wished he was married to the third Miss Ju, the most beautiful girl she had ever seen. His wife was homely and silent, 4 years older than him and seeming much older still. Fortunately, she seldom saw them together. The rules of the day did not call for it. They had two children. She was the daughter of a warlord in Sichuan who had saved the old marshal's life once. In gratitude, he married his son to his benefactor's daughter. To Fourth Miss, it was one more thing to admire in the young marshal, to have paid his father's debt with his own life, so to speak. She never heard the Jew sisters mentioned at home without a snicker, running wild and their father less them. Once the bad name is out, even the youngest will suffer by it. Huh, the famous Ju sisters people will say. The fourth Miss Chu did not have to be warned of them. She felt like a country cousin. Even the fifth Ju ignored her except this one time when she asked, "Have you seen the young marshal?" "No." "Go look for him." "What for?" "Tell him somebody is looking for him." "Who?" "Not me anyway." "Can't you go yourself?" "I can't. It's all right for you." "You're not much older." "I look older." "How should I know where to look? I'm just to tell him something without head or tail." Little devil. People seldom ask you anything and you put on airs. The fifth Jew hit her laughing. She hit back and ran. "You want to go? Go yourself." Rushing out of the crowd, she went straight to look for the young marshal. Once out among the men, she had to watch out for her father and half-brothers. Keep close to the wall, run for cover behind pot of flowers, wander around the corridor walks pretending she did not quite know where she was. Fruit blossoms appeared in pale masses where the lights touched them in the courtyards. Servants bearing dishes went in and out the curtained doorways. A hubbub everywhere and music instruments being tuned. She was a tree growing toward a lighted window all her life. At last, tall enough to peer in. Thanks for listening. I am Missy Hyper, aka Slash Queen. That was chapter 1, and stay tuned for chapter 2.